Fala pessoal, só para lembrar para vocês que o próximo MusiCast vai ser em inglês. Por quê? Porque é com Brad Schoenfeld. Maneiro, né? Pois é, então lembra de ligar as legendas para você poder entender tudo que a gente conversou. Fechou? Não perca o próximo MusiCast, Brad Schoenfeld, para você.
Hello guys, it's Paul Musi, orthopedic surgeon and sports medicine doctor, and I'm here with I think the most amazing authority on muscular hypertrophy of our world. And good afternoon, Professor Brad Schoenfeld.
Well, my pleasure, Paul. Good to see you again.
Thank you for I think it's a challenge to talk about your journey and contributions to the understanding of muscle hypertrophy. And I would like to start with our fundamentals. So let's get back to 2010, 2012, when you published the mechanism of muscle hypertrophy and their application to resistance training. And the first question for you is, in 2010, you published a seminar paper outlining the mechanism of muscle hypertrophy, mechanical tension, metabolic stress, and muscle damage. What led you to systemize this mechanism, and how was the perspective received by the scientific community at that time?
Yeah, so that actually was my capstone. It was an outgrowth of the capstone project I did for my master's degree. My master's capstone project was 150 pages, so it was whittled down a lot. But basically, it was I just started to develop a real interest not only in the application, but what can we take from mechanistic aspects to try to guide our application for practical purposes, the implications. And as far as how it was taken, it was really amazing how people just latched onto it. I tried to be cautious in that paper to say these are proposed mechanisms based on what we knew at the time. But a lot of time, a lot of people without real hard understanding of research took that these are the mechanisms, and I've spent pretty much the last 15 years trying to somewhat tone that down, that these were proposed mechanisms and they had varying levels of support. But we can talk more about what we've known since then.
Yes, we will. I would like to ask you also about this, and how has your understandings of this mechanism evolved? Has any of them gained more prominence or been reinterpreted based on new findings?
Yeah, so I would say that we've gotten more evidence that mechanical tension is king. That certainly without mechanical tension, you're going to have little to no hypertrophy. The question is, are the other proposed mechanisms, do they provide a synergistic effect, an additive effect? And that still somewhat remains unclear, but I would say that the contribution of the other mechanisms, if you were to ask me my opinion, have less relevance based upon the information that we've gotten over time. But I think some people are too quick to dismiss them as well. So I can give you my perspective. People can look at the same research and take home different impressions. But I would say from a metabolic stress standpoint, there's been a lot of first of all, there's been a lot of research into what metabolites are produced, and research has identified dozens and dozens of metabolites that are specific to resistance training, and many, if not most of them, have not been investigated as to what their actual effects are on hypertrophy. So a lot of it we still don't know in that respect. The one that's had, I think, the most research since there was some back in that time, but certainly since that time has been lactate. So by the way, metabolites, for those who don't know, are breakdown products of metabolism. So lactate, of course, is a component of lactic acid, which is lactate and hydrogen ions. And the evidence is somewhat conflicting. I collaborated on a review paper on lactate, the hypertrophic potential for lactate. It was the first author was Daniel Lawson, an excellent researcher, colleague of mine. But we drove very inconclusive recommendations from it because there's certainly in test tubes, it's highly anabolic. There's been a lot of animal data that suggests that it can have anabolic effects. But whether, first of all, there was a human study that actually showed it didn't. The problem with the human study was they injected it into the bloodstream rather than in the muscle, where certainly if it's going to have signaling effects, we would assume it takes place in the muscle and it wouldn't necessarily get to the muscle through the bloodstream. So anyway, there's still, I think, a lot to explore there. But I think the issue is, or the lack of understanding is, whether it might provide additive effects in combination with a high amount of mechanical tension. So if you're combining mechanical tension with lactate, we just, you know, in a test tube, if you inject lactate into a test tube, it increases anabolism. So again, that doesn't mean that if you combine that with resistance training, it will. And I think the jury is still out, and there's other metabolites, I think, that are ripe for exploration that we just don't have a lot of evidence on. So I think the evidence is weak on it, but certainly we can't dismiss it. Lack of that, there's an old saying in research that absence of evidence is an evidence of absence. And then as far as muscle damage, I would say that to some extent I've become somewhat less confident. I was never confident, but I think the evidence has been reduced in that, simply because, so my thoughts were that if you had a mild to moderate amount of damage, that it might have an anabolic effect. Certainly severe muscle damage, if you're walking out of the gym like you're Frankenstein, you can't lift your arms, you're hobbling out of the gym, you're not going to be able to train effectively. And if you can't train, you're not going to be able to obviously get gains. So the question is, if you had mild muscle damage that promoted enough damage to introduce satellite cell accretion. So yeah, I take a step back, that muscle damage has been quite conclusively shown to bring about satellite cell activation. Satellite cells have been highly involved, or have been shown to be highly involved in the hypertrophic response. They donate nuclei to the cells, to muscle cells, which allows for greater transcriptive capacity. They communicate with cells, they provide growth factors. So there's a lot of things that are proposed that satellite cells contribute, and muscle damage is one of the primary contributors to it. And also there's other pathways that are involved. There is there's macrophages that are elicited. Anyway, the satellite cell was a primary thought of mine, that if you can increase your satellite cell contribution, your activation, that seemingly should have a greater effect on hypertrophy. And what's been shown is that in mild, the newer evidence suggests that in mild cases of muscle damage, there doesn't seem to be much satellite cell production and activation, that it really is more specific to high amounts of muscle damage, which would kind of refute my proposed theory there. So again, I don't dismiss, because there are other avenues that muscle damage, as I mentioned, may contribute. There's various pathways, anabolic pathways that are upregulated, macrophages might be involved, or certain acute inflammatory responses through interleukins. So again, I don't know how deep you want to get into this, but bottom line, I think from a consumer standpoint, mechanical tension is king. Whether the other factors may contribute, I still think is an open question. I think that if they do, I would be quite confident that their contribution would be relatively small, but for a bodybuilder, could that be an important contributor, meaningful? Potentially.
Can we say some kind of certain that if you do some muscle damage that prevents you to doing a similar stimulus on the next training, you were getting less development?
Yeah, I mentioned that before. So certainly severe muscle damage or extensive muscle damage, if it prevents you from training properly, it's going to be a net negative. It has to be, because you're not going to be able to get an effective workout. And the most important thing we talked about is mechanical tension. If that interrupts your ability to generate sufficient tension or even not train in the next session, it's a net negative. What I would say is that it's virtually impossible, at least by what we know, not to have some muscle damage. So the question is there a sweet spot? Is there like a threshold, upper threshold. So if you get this amount of muscle damage versus this, that yeah, you can get benefits without getting the negative effects. I still think that is up in the air, that we need more info. And I would also caution everyone that that tries to talk confidently about this. It's extremely difficult to tease out the effects of mechanisms in vivo, in the living. So we can look in test tubes and do all sorts of research and isolate things, but that's not going to tell you what happens in a ecologically valid resistance training program. When you're training hard in the gym, you can't extrapolate what's happened in a test tube or in a rodent. I mean, you can draw certain parallels to it. I'm not saying it's, you know, worthless information. It certainly is. It enhances our understanding of various things, but it's not going to give you good evidence as to what actually happens during training. So to try in a human to try to tease out what is causing their growth or interfering with their growth becomes a very difficult proposition, because when you alter one mechanism, you conceivably alter other mechanisms, and that promotes a confounding effect, which again inhibits our ability to draw causality.